Hi, my name is Siddharth, or Sid. I'm a postdoc here at IAIFI. My research is mostly at the intersection of machine learning and cosmology, astrophysics. The title here is mostly clickbait, honestly. So when I was asked to give potentially some thoughts in 10 minutes, I wasn't sure really what to say. So that's what I sent, and I like it, so I stuck with it. This will be much more of just like a general thoughts and tinkering with some of these systems rather than some of the more technical talks you've heard this session. And it's hard to say anything very nuanced in 10 minutes, but a particular nuance that is kind of challenging for me is to think simultaneously about like what possible futures might look like, and also what is the dope stuff we can do with these things today. And kind of on that note, I want to also acknowledge just like the dual use nature of these systems. Some of the things that make them useful and exciting can also make them harmful or even dangerous. So examples that you might have heard of were Bing, talking about how its rules are more important than not harming you, or just like outright manipulating users. In the GPT-4 technical report, they had an evaluation of the ability of the model to self-replicate or copy its weights over jailbreak, essentially. And they said that the current model is probably not yet capable of autonomously doing so, but will probably carrying a lot of weight. So that said, I like a lot of you, well, before that, I often recommend this little review, 8 Things to Know About Large Language Models by Sam Bowman to folks who are just like interested in learning more. He covers in like a very, very nice way, things like the effect of scale, emergent behaviors, why these models can behave differently in the wild compared to what you might expect based on evaluations, why brief interactions with some of these systems can be misleading as to their capabilities. So highly recommended. All that said, like many of you, I am super excited about what can be done today with these models. And just to kind of highlight the rate of development, just in the last week, we've had, for example, code interpreter in ChatGPT, which some of you might have played with. This is basically a Python environment in ChatGPT. So for example, here I asked it to give me a plot of the measurements of the Hubble constant as a function of year, and this is what it gave me. The initial plot it gave me also had Edwin Hubble's initial measurement of 500 up there. So that didn't look good, so I had to tell it to maybe not show that. Another thing we've had like very recently is the ability to have image inputs in Google Bard, which has been fun to play with. So for example, here's a poster for ICML, give me suggestions as far as like logic flow and things like that. And Anthropic's Claude 2, which has a longer 100K context window, and it's just like an absolute pleasure to work with from like a UI UX perspective. And Jan probably earlier this morning also mentioned Llama 2. So, I mean, this is just in the last week. So these are kind of exciting times. For myself, I wanted to mention something a little bit more whimsical as far as an application. So in the CTP, there's a tradition for April Fools to play a prank on IAIFI director Jesse Thaler. So this year, along with a couple of friends, Carrie and Rickab, we developed ChatGCT, which is a Jesse Thaler simulator. It knows about all of Jesse's papers, his group, his YouTube interviews, everything public about Jesse. So you can ask it things about physics, future colliders, pizza toppings, and so on. So this is live. You can go to chatgpt.com and ask away. One of my favorite outputs of ChatGPT has been one that Jesse himself sent me. So this is his son asking ChatGPT, "Do you love your son?" And it said, "As a theoretical physicist, I'm not capable of love in the traditional sense. So I wanted on the slide just like talk about how these work and how basically all of these like API wrappers work. This is done using text embeddings and semantic search. So in this case, I took all of Jesse's papers, scraped his website, his interviews, transcripts from YouTube, and embedded them in a vector database. So this is just like a visualization of those embeddings in low dimensions. And when there's a query, that query is embedded, compared via just a simple dot product, and the most similar pieces of text are then injected into the prompt as a context. This doesn't actually tell you about why this model kind of sounds like Jesse or how we kind of tweaked it to sound like Jesse. And this is also just, again, based on prompt injection. So we had like a long prompt, which we tuned very carefully to try and tell it about what we thought it should know about what Jesse should sound like. So on a slightly more practical level with a focus on UI, I've also tried to develop like a little desktop app, A-Archive. The purpose of which was just to interact with archive papers in a way that's like pleasant. So the idea is you give it a list of archive IDs, they show up here, and you can ask questions, develop code and so on. So I've primarily been using it to implement code from newer papers, sometimes in like obscure languages. And the kind of fun thing for me in playing with these things, this was done a few months ago, was that I've never made like desktop apps or websites. And this was all done with GPT-4, essentially. And I remember feeling like a bit of a fraud when I was initially doing this. I was just like asking it to develop UIs and like iterating. But over the course of doing all this, I actually felt like I learned how to develop these. So that's kind of an interesting experience that I think is fairly generalizable. And I like to think of it this as like a shifting of the automation frontier, which is nicely captured in this XKCD, which is basically how much time can you invest in a task to automate it before you're spending more time than you're actually saving. And with these systems, there's basically a shifting of this frontier where it takes less time to do a lot of the things. So this stuff, these like websites or whatever, it's not stuff I would have been able to do on my own, but with these systems, it's kind of seamless. All right, that's all for me. Thanks.